Good morning. To have some of the most talented fingers in the country right here this morning with us. So, thank you. It's the dueling banjo mandolin thing. That's pretty awesome. At one point, I felt like I should have gone on a horse, though, there, Darren. So, that was good. So, we're so glad you joined us this morning for our 909 outdoor service. 4th of July, one day away. So what a great way to celebrate our freedom and to be outdoors praising the Lord. So thank you for joining us, whether you're a regular or you're here on a regular basis. We're just glad to see you. And it's awesome to see this square so full. I've seen it transformed over the years, and I cannot think of a better purpose than holding church here this morning. So as we celebrate our freedom, it makes me think that freedom and Christianity have a lot in common. In their purest forms, they're very messy. Freedom doesn't always mean what we think it does, and Christianity means so much to so many of us. But with both, we have the grace of Jesus Christ that covers it, because we're all a mess, one way or the other. So I think Randy uses the word white hot mess, but we are. But we have the grace of Jesus Christ. So I'm so glad that we're here this morning, and we acknowledge that, how much we need him. So if you'll bear with me, let's go to the Lord in prayer and get this morning started. Almighty and merciful God, freedom can be a difficult thing, but we are so grateful for those 240 some odd years ago that fought so that we could have freedom, freedom to worship you in a way that is pleasing to you. Sometimes it's not pretty. Sometimes we don't worship you appropriately, but you give us that freedom, and it definitely brings us closer to you in the end, because we need you. And we need the salvation that comes from your Son, Jesus Christ. So the Lord, this morning we just ask that as we celebrate the freedom of this country and all that gave their lives so that we can enjoy it to this day, on July 3rd, 2022, we just pray for your continued blessing upon our country. And it's in your holy name I pray. Amen. All right. And you can either be seated or we can all rise. And our first song this morning, none other than America the Beautiful.
Control my fear.
Thank you, Lee. Thank you, band. And in case you're wondering, I did put extra sunscreen on this morning because I'm definitely in the light here. Bright sun. So, one correction in the bulletin you see is Wednesday night supper. There is no Wednesday night supper this week. So if you want a meal, we're doing a hot dog cookout at the ball field on Monday. The Rotary Club is. So come have a really good hot dog on Monday between 11 and 1 p.m. This is our time for joys. If you have any joys, I'm not going to be able to bring you the microphone because they've tethered me today. But just stand up and give us your joy. I see lots of families visiting with each other, and that looks like an amazing joy. I have a joy. My mother-in-law is here this morning, Barbara Matthews. So thanks for being with us this morning, Barbara. So, any other joys out there? Yes?
My husband Evan's birthday today.
Oh, we got a special song for you.
Happy birthday to you.
And anybody else that had a birthday, that's for you too. So, Betty Ann, do you have a joy for us?
Yes. Tomorrow, Ty and I will be married 53 years. Woo!
Well, we have another special song for the anniversaries out there.
Happy anniversary.
Happy anniversary.
Original that Lee wrote, so thank you, Lee. We appreciate that. Okay, any other joys out there? Yes? Is that Jackson? All right. That was pretty impressive. We really liked that. So, if you were at music last night, they had a electric guitar guest, and that was Price's grandson, Jackson. Is that right? Okay. Thanks for doing that. That was awesome. Yeah. Don? Right, that song was for you, too. So happy birthday, and we're glad you're with us. Okay. Yes?
I drove up from Florida yesterday, and track wasn't bad at all.
All right. And I don't think they're having an outdoor church anywhere in Florida today. What do you think? So, yeah, it's a little hot there, so that's why we have so many lovely people that join us in Highlands for the summer. Okay, any other joys out there? Okay, and I don't think I have any other announcements, and now's the time in our service. I think we're going to do offer our gifts to God. So if I could get a few folks come up here and help me pass these out, pass them around the buckets, that would be great. Thank you. outside, so maybe we should do this one more. Good stuff. Before I pray for our offering this morning, I just another joy is that we got to celebrate, speaking of stewardship and offering our gifts to God. On Wednesday night, we celebrated, we had a little ice cream party to celebrate the paying off of our debt a year ago. So many people came together to help retire a $1.5 million debt for our beautiful Faith and Fellowship Center that we really hope will, for years to come, touch the community in so many different ways. So we're trying to make that building as open as possible, as many opportunities for folks. So I'm going to offer a prayer, but I just want to say thank you for that. Heavenly Father, you have entrusted each and every one of us with a variety of gifts. Lord, some financial, some spiritual, some just being able to touch folks in the community through kindness and gentleness. So this morning, Lord, as we offer these gifts, not just the financial gifts, but the gifts that everybody gives throughout the week, we just ask for your blessing. Help our hearts to be as pure and clean as possible so that we can glorify you in all that we do. We pray that these financial gifts this morning, we would be good stewards of them so that they truly glorify your kingdom. And it's in the holy name of Jesus that I pray. Amen. All right. Now, one of my favorite parts of our service is we do our prayers to the cross. If you haven't had a chance, you're welcome, as the band plays, to come up and write a prayer and put it on the cross. This is just symbolic of Jesus dying on that cross so that we can have a relationship with God. And a lot of times, sin separates us from that relationship from God, and the cross is the opportunity to get beyond that. So whether it's a Thanksgiving or a prayer or something you're struggling with, I would encourage you to either write something, put it on the cross, or just look up here and offer it to God. So when I look at the cross, I think of during the time when Jesus walked this earth, this was a weapon. This was something that was not good. Crucifying someone on a cross is a horrible death that lasts too long. But again, I look at so much of my own life, and I'm sure you can all relate, it's like God can take something that's not good and make it good. And in my own life, I know that he's taking stuff that was not good and ended up making it good for me, and I'm sure we can all relate to that. And when I look at the cross, I think that's the power of the cross, is that God can even make something as bad as a cross good for us. So let me pray. Heavenly Father, we bring these prayers to the cross this morning, whether we physically place them on the cross or we sit in our chair and we offer them to you. So Lord, I just pray for each and every person that is here today that may be struggling with something, a relationship, financial issues, just peace in their own life, health issues, so many things that we struggle with. Lord, I also want to acknowledge Thanksgiving for just families being together, and several folks have acknowledged that this morning, just the joy of family to the point of bringing tears of just being together. So Lord, if there's anyone out here this morning that's struggling with a relationship, with a family member, I pray that your mighty hand would be upon them and that they would open new pathways to connect with those folks, because family is just so critical, not just the church family, but our family, our blood family that we are with every day. So thank you for this opportunity to go to the cross. Thank you for the relationship that we get through Christ your Son. And we pray this morning. Amen. All right, Lee, shall we gather at the river or town square?
Seated. Well, I'll echo Gary's welcome and thank you for being here. What a lovely crowd. We are delighted to be able to gather in Town Square again. It's the first time since 2019. And I want to say a word of thanks at the beginning to the volunteers. As you can imagine, this doesn't just happen. We had a lot of people out here as early as 7:30 this morning, stacking chairs, bringing chairs, stacking chairs, setting everything up. And they'll be tearing everything down at the end of the service, so everything will look normal here for the folks in Town Square. But I'm so grateful to all the volunteers who make this happen. Would you give them a nice round of applause for each of them? So I thought I would do something a little bit different this morning for our gathering. As we were gathering outside a number of years ago, 2012 actually, got involved with the Network of Biblical Storytellers, and the mission of the network is to encourage people to learn and tell biblical stories, a reminder that before the Bible was print, written down in a book form, there were stories, many stories that were shared for generations among people. And so that's what I'm going to do today. I'm actually going to share with you, instead of preaching a sermon to you, I know you're disappointed that I'm not going to preach you a sermon, but I'm going to share with you three stories. Three creation stories. There are actually three creation stories in the Bible. There's two in the book of Genesis, one right after the other, and then there's one in the Gospel of John. And so I'm going to share with you those creation stories. Let me just say a brief word about them, but not anything that would qualify for a sermon. But I do want to just invite you, as we are out in the midst of God's good creation, celebrating being able to be together again in a way that we haven't in quite a long time. I just feel that my heart is filled with joy as we gather on this 4th of July weekend. Jerry's already given voice to the freedoms that we so deeply enjoy and often enjoy and easily sometimes can take for granted, right? I mean, I think one thing that COVID taught us was how much we missed being together, how much we needed community. And so I just find that my heart is full this morning looking out among you today. And I invite you just to join me as we celebrate these stories of God's good creation. The first story I'm going to tell you is at the very beginning of the book of Genesis, Genesis chapter 1, verses chapter 1, verse 1 through chapter 2, verse 4a. You can stop it in different places. I stop it at 4a. And this is the seven-day creation story. And a lot of scholars would suggest that this story was finalized during the 6th century BCE by the priestly tradition while the children of Israel were in bondage, exile is the better word, in Babylon. And many suggest that part of the reason why this story came about, it was a pushback against some of the other ancient creation narratives. All ancient people had creation narratives. And the Babylonian people had a very violent creation narrative. It's called the Enuma Elish. And the basic idea in the Babylonian creation narrative is that there was a war between the gods, and out of that war, Marduk defeated Tiamat, who I think was his grandmother god, and out of that violence, out of her body, creation was made. So it was a very violent story of creation. And so the children of Israel, very much the priestly tradition, the priests said, no, that's not the way it happened at all. Our God did not create out of violence. The God of creation spoke and creation came into being. So it's a very beautiful and poetic story that came out of that season, the 6th century BCE, if you will. So I'm going to share with you that story now. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. And God saw that the light was good. God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And it was evening, and it was morning the first day. And God said, let there be a dome in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters. So God made the dome and separated the waters that were under the dome from the waters that were above the dome, and it was so. God called the dome sky. And there was evening, there was morning, the second day. And God said, let the waters under the sky be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear. And it was so. God called the dry land earth, and the waters that were gathered together he called sea. Then God said, let the earth bring forth vegetation, plants yielding seed, and fruit trees of every kind on the face of the earth that bear fruit with the seed in it. And it was so. The earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seed, fruit trees of every kind, bearing fruit with the seed in it. And God saw that it was good. There was evening and there was morning the third day. And God said, let there be lights in the dome of the sky. And let them separate the day from the night. And let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and for years. And let them be lights in the dome of the sky to give light upon the earth. So God made the two great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night and the stars. God set them in the dome of the sky to give light upon the earth, to rule over the day and over the night and to separate the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. And it was evening and it was morning the fourth day. God said, let the waters bring forth swarms of living creatures, and let the birds fly across the dome of the sky. So God made the great sea monsters and every winged creature with which every living creature with which the waters swarm, and every winged bird of every kind. And God saw that it was good. God blessed them, saying to them, be fruitful and fill the waters of the seas, let the birds multiply on the earth. And there was evening and there was morning the fifth day. And God said, let the earth bring forth living creatures of every kind, cattle of every kind, and creeping things of every kind, wild animals of the earth of every kind. So God made the wild animals of the earth of every kind, and the cattle of every kind, and the creeping things of every kind. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, let us make humankind in our image, and according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds over the air and over every living thing that moves upon the face of the earth. So God made humankind in his image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them. God said to them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it. And have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds over the air and over all the wild animals of the earth, everything that moves upon the face of the earth. God said, see, I have given you every tree that is good for food and every plant with seed in it. And to every beast of the field, to every bird of the air, to everything that creeps upon the face of the earth, I have given every green plant for food. And it was so. God saw everything that he had made, and indeed, it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all their multitude. And on the seventh day, God finished his work. And he rested on the seventh day from all the work that he had done. And God blessed the seventh day and hallowed it, because on it God rested from all the work that he had done in creation. These are the generations of the heavens and the earth when they were created. Now, scholars suggest that, some rabbis suggest that the main reason we have that wonderful creation story is to teach us about the Sabbath. To teach us about the value of rest. And one of the things that, about that story that just fills my heart is the reminder that God made creation good. God spoke it into existence. And God's creation is good. And each of us are created in God's likeness. Now, at our 8:30 Summer Eucharist service just a few minutes ago, we talked about identity. We celebrate identity. As a nation, this weekend, we celebrate identity. As the church, as we gather in worship, we celebrate and acknowledge our own identity. And one thing I would say to you before I tell you the next story is that sometimes it's easy to forget who we are. We get pushed and pulled in a lot of directions, and life can be hard, and sometimes we can forget important things. And I've come to believe that part of my role as a preacher is not to tell you things you don't know, but to remind you of things you do know and maybe have forgotten. So let me remind you, beloved, your chief identity is as a child of God, created in the very image of God. The divine nature is within you. Now, the second story I'm going to tell is an older story. It's a story that perhaps some suggest was around the 10th century BCE when this story kind of formulated. And when the priestly folks put the book of Genesis together, they decided to keep this story as part of the biblical canon for the Hebrew people, for the Jewish folks. We claim it, of course, in our Christian tradition as well. It's the story of Adam and Eve that you're familiar with as well. And you'll notice, perhaps, that the name of God is different in this story. God is referred to as Lord God, whereas in the other story was referenced, the deity was referenced as God. But this story is more of an earthy story, and this story kind of falls in that category of etiological stories. It's a story that teaches us about the origins of things. It's a story that tells us why there is sin in the world. Why, if God created a good creation, why are things not always good? Why are things imperfect? Well, this second story speaks to that. This is the book of Genesis, chapter 2, verse 4b, through chapter 3, verse 24. In the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens, when no plant of the field had yet sprung up, and no herb of the field had yet sprung forth, for the Lord God had not caused it to rain upon the earth, and there was no one to till the ground, but a spring would rise above the ground and water the whole face of the earth. The Lord God formed man out of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living being. And the Lord God planted a garden in Eden in the east. There he put the man whom he had formed. And out of the ground the Lord God made to grow every tree that is a delight to the eyes and good for food, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil in the midst of the garden, and the tree of life A river flows out of Eden and divides and becomes four branches. The name of the first is Pishon. It's the one that flows around the whole land of Havilah, where there is gold, and the gold of that land is good. Bdellium and onyx stone are there. The name of the second river is the Gihon. It's the one that flows around the whole land of Cush. The name of the third river is the Tigris, which flows east of Assyria. And the fourth river is the Euphrates. The Lord God took the man and put him in the garden to till it and to keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, "You may freely eat of any tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you may not eat. For in the day that you eat of it, you shall die." The Lord God said, "It's not good for the man to be alone. I will make him a helper as his partner." So out of the ground, the Lord God calls to grow every wild animal of the field, every animal, every cat, all the cattle, and he brought them to the man to see what he would name them. And whatever the name the man gave to each living creature, that was its name. So the man gave names to all the cattle and all the birds and all the animals of the field, but there was still not found for the man a helper as his partner. So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and he slept. He took a rib from his side, covered it over with flesh, and from the rib that the Lord God had taken from the man, he made woman and brought her to the man. And the man said, "Whoa, man!" That's my own little editorial comment. And the man said, "This at last is bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. This one shall be called woman, for out of man this one was taken. Therefore a man will leave his father and his mother and cling to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh." And the man and his wife were both naked and were not ashamed. Now the serpent was more crafty than any other animal that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God say, 'You shall not eat from any tree of the garden?'" And the woman said, "No, God said we may eat from any tree of the garden, but we shall not eat from the tree in the middle of the garden, nor shall we touch it, or we will die." And the serpent said, "You will not die. For God knows that when you eat of this, you will become like God, knowing good and evil." And when the woman saw that the tree was a delight to the eyes and the food was desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit and she ate. She gave it to her husband, who was with her. He ate. And their eyes were open. They saw they were naked. They sewed fig leaves together. They heard the sound of the Lord God walking the time of the evening breeze, and they hid themselves among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God said to the man, "Where are you?" The man said, "I heard you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid myself." The Lord God said, "Who told you you were naked? Have you eaten of the tree which I commanded you not to eat?" And the man said, "The woman, whom you gave to be with me, gave me the fruit, and I ate." The Lord God said to the woman, "What is this that you've done?" And the woman said, "The serpent tricked me, and I ate." And the Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, cursed are you among all animals and among all living creatures. Upon your belly you shall go, and dust you shall eat all the days of your life. I will put enmity between you and the woman, between her offspring and yours. His head will strike your heel, and his heel will strike your head. Your head will strike his heel." And to the woman he said, "I will greatly increase your pains in childbearing. In pain you shall bring forth children, but your desire will be for your husband. He will rule over you. To the man he said, because you have listened to the voice of your wife and have eaten of the fruit that I told you not to eat, cursed is the ground because of you. In toil you shall eat of it all the days of your life. Thorns and thistles it will bring forth for you. You will eat bread by the sweat of your brow till you return to the ground. Dust you are, and to dust you shall return. The man named his wife Eve, because she was the mother of all living. And the Lord God sewed skins together and clothed the man and the woman. The Lord God said, see, man has become like one of us, knowing good and evil. Now he might reach out and take from the tree of life and live forever. So the Lord God sent forth the man out of the Garden of Eden to till the ground out of which he came. And the Lord God placed a cherubim at the Garden of Eden with a sword flaming and turning to guard the way to the tree of life. So the next story, if you were to read the book of Genesis, I'm not telling this story, but the very next story is the story of Cain and Abel. And we begin to see in the Bible, speaking of the goodness of God and also the frailty of humanity. We see that. One of the things we find out when we read the scriptures, we find out about ourselves. We find out about God, but we learn about ourselves as well. And one of the things about this particular story that I just shared with you is a reminder of how sometimes we try to supplant God. We try to become our own God. We want to be equal with God. If I can tell you a little joke, I love what a little joke that Mark Twain was credited as saying. He said, in the beginning, God created man in his image, and man, being the gentleman that he is, has been trying to return the favor ever since. We are tempted to try to create God in our own image, but that is not the way to do it. We are created in the blessed image of God. So one final story I'll tell you, and then I'll conclude my time with you. In the New Testament, in the fourth gospel, the gospel of John, John has a very high Christology. John tells the story at the beginning of creation, and he talks about how God is made known through Christ. And so I invite you to hear just these 16 verses of the beginning of the gospel of John. It goes like this. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him. Without him, not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light, the true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, but his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood, or the will of the flesh, or the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us. And we have seen his glory, the glory as of the Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. John cried out and testified, this is he of whom I said, the one who comes after me ranks ahead of me because he was before me. From his fullness we have all received grace upon grace. Indeed, the law came through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. One final thought I'll leave with you before we sing Amazing Grace. We do celebrate God's good creation. We do acknowledge our fallenness as human beings, but we are reminded today that there is a spark of God within us. And so we ask God's help and God's grace to enliven that spark, so that the goodness of God may flow freely through us. And the Gospel of John reminds us that our fullest understanding of God is in the person of Jesus. And I would remind you of this, and perhaps you can bear witness in your own life. You may have experienced God in powerful moments of worship or singing, but my guess is you have experienced God in transformative ways through others. through the love and grace and kindness and generosity and compassion of others. And I would suggest to you, when that happens, the Word continues to be made flesh to dwell among us. And to that I say, thanks be to God. I invite you to stand as you are able. Let us sing together as the band leads us in Amazing Grace.
Thank you, everybody, for taking time out of your Sunday morning and joining us for worship this morning. Randy, thank you for reminding us where we come from, our history, our origin. And we all have a little bit different take in our own lives since your earthly existence started. And for our country, as we celebrate the 4th of July tomorrow, where we came from. And like I mentioned earlier, so much sacrifice so that we can be here and worship openly our God. So we are all, I know, grateful for that. So as I send you forward, just remember, your freedom is very special and very powerful. Just like God gave Adam and Eve their freedom, be careful with it. And may God bless you and keep you. And we're going to fly away. Lee, Charles, Sarah, Lee.